Today, the 6th of May, 2021, I'm going to read to you chapter 3 from the book Women Who Run with the Wolves by Clarissa Pinkola Estes. Nosing out the facts, the retrieval of intuition as initiation. The doll in her pocket. Vasilisa the Wise. Intuition is the treasure of a woman's psyche. It is like a divining instrument and like a crystal through which one can see with uncanny interior vision. It is like a wise old woman who is with you always, who tells you exactly what the matter is, tells you exactly whether you need to go left or right. It is a form of the one who knows. Old La Que Sabe, the wild woman. In the traditions I was raised in, dedicated storytellers were always off under some psychic hill up to their knees in story lust, brushing away centuries of dirt, digging under overlays of culture and conquests, numbering every frieze and fresco of story they could find. Sometimes a story has been reduced to powder. Sometimes portions and details are missing or rubbed out. Often the form is intact, but the coloring is destroyed. But even so, every dig holds hope for finding an entire body of story intact and unbroken. The following tale is just such an incredible treasure. To my mind, the old Russian tale Vasilisa is a woman's initiation story with few essential bones astray. It is about the realization that most things are not as they seem. As women, we call upon our intuition and instincts in order to sniff things out. We use all our senses to wring the truth from things, to extract nourishment from our own ideas. To see what there is to see, to know what there is to know, to be the keepers of our own creative fires, and to have an intimate knowing about the life, death, life cycles of all nature. This is an initiated woman. Stories with Vasilisa as a central character are told in Russia, Romania, Yugoslavia, Poland, and throughout all the Baltic countries. In some instances, the tale is commonly called Vasilisa the Wise. I find evidence of its archetypal roots dating back at least to the old horse goddess cults which predate classical Greek culture. This tale carries ages-old psychic mapping about induction into the underworld of the wild female god. It is about infusing human women with wild woman's primary instinctual power, intuition. The pattern for my literary version of the Vasilisa tale, spun here, was given to me by my aunt Kathe. It begins with one of the oldest storytelling devices. Once there was, and once there was not. This paradoxical phrase is meant to alert the soul of the listener that this story takes place in the world between worlds where nothing is as it first seems. So let us begin. Vasilisa. Once there was, and once there was not, a young mother who lay in her deathbed, her face pale as the white wax roses in the sacristy of the church nearby. Her young daughter and her husband sat at the end of her old wooden bed and prayed that God would guide her safely into the next world. The dying mother called to Vasilisa, and the little child in red boots and white apron knelt at her mother's side. "Here is a doll for you, my love," the mother whispered, and from the hairy coverlet she pulled a tiny doll, which, like Vasilisa herself, was dressed in red boots, white apron, black skirt and vest, embroidered all over with colored thread. "Here are my last words, beloved," said the mother. "Should you lose your way or be in need of help, ask this doll what to do. You will be assisted. Keep the doll with you always. Do not tell anyone about her. Feed her when she is hungry. This is my mother's promise to you, my blessing on you, dear daughter." And with that, the mother's breath fell into the depth of her body, where it gathered up her soul and rushed out from beneath, between her lips, and the mother was dead. The child and her father mourned for a very long time. But like the field cruelly ploughed under by war, the father's life grows green from the furrows again. And he married a widow with two daughters. Although the new stepmother and her daughter spoke in polite tones and always smiled like ladies, there was something of the rodents behind their smiles, which Vasilisa's father didn't perceive. Sure enough, when the three women were alone with Vasilisa, they tormented her, forced her to wait on them, sent her to chop wood so her lovely skin would become blemished. They hated her because she had a sweetness about her that was otherworldly. She was also very beautiful. Her breasts were bounding while theirs dwindled from meanness. She was helpful and uncomplaining, while the stepmother and stepsisters were, among themselves, like rats in the offal pile at night. One day, the stepmother and stepsisters simply could not stand Vasilisa any longer. "Let us conspire to make the fire go out, and then let us send Vasilisa into the forest to Baba Gaya, Yaga. Very different. Let us conspire to make the fire go out, and then let us send Vasilisa into the forest to baby Baba Yaga, the witch, to beg fire for our hearth. And when she reaches Baba Yaga, well, old Baba Yaga will kill her and eat her." Oh, they all clapped and squeaked like things that live in the dark. So that evening, when Vasilisa came home from gathering wood, the entire house was dark. She was very concerned and inquired of her stepmother, "What has happened? What will we have to cook with? What will we do to light the darkness?" The stepmother admonished, "You stupid child, obviously we have no fire, and I can't go out into the woods because I'm old. My daughters can't go because they are afraid, so you are the only one who can go out into the forest to find Baba Yaga and get a coal to start our fire again." Vasilisa replied innocently, "Well, all right, yes, I'll do that," and so she set out. The woods became darker and darker, and sticks cracked under her feet, frightening her. She reached down in the long, deep pocket of her apron. And there was the doll her dying mother had given her. And Vasilisa patted the doll in her pocket and said, "Just touching this doll, yes, I feel better." And at every fork in the road, Vasilisa reached into her pocket and consulted the doll. "Well, should I go to the left or should I go to the right?" The doll indicated yes or no, or this way or that way, and Vasilisa fed the doll some of her bread as she walked and followed what she felt was emanating from the doll. Suddenly a man in white on a white horse galloped by, and it became daylight. Farther on, a man in red sauntered by on a red horse, and the sun rose. Vasilisa walked and walked, and just as she came to the hovel of Baba Yaga, a rider dressed in black came trotting on a black horse and rode right into Baba Yaga's hut. Swiftly it became light. The fence made of skulls and bones surrounding the hut began to blaze with an inner fire, so the clearing there in the forest glowed with an eerie light. Now the Baba Yaga was a very fearsome creature. She travelled not in a chariot, not in a coach, but in a cauldron shaped like a mortar, which flew along all by itself. She rode this vehicle with an oar shaped like a pestle, and all the while she swept out the tracks of where she'd been with a broom made from the hair of a person long dead. And the cauldron flew through the sky with Baba Yaga's own greasy hair flying behind. Her long chin curved up and her long nose curved down, and they met in the middle. She had a tiny white goatee and warts on her skin from her trade in toads. Her brown stained fingernails were thick and ridged like roofs, and so curled over she could not make a fist. Even more strange was the Baba Yaga's house. It sat up atop huge, scaly, yellow chicken legs and walked about all by itself and sometimes twirled around and around like an ecstatic dancer. The bolts on the doors and shutters were made of human fingers and toes, and the lock on the front door was a snout with many pointed teeth. Vasilisa consulted her doll and asked, "Is this the house we seek?" And the doll, on its own way, answered, "Yes, this is what you seek." And before she could take another step, Baba Yaga in her cauldron descended on Vasilisa and shouted down at her, "What do you want?" And the girl trembled. "Grandmother, I come for fire. My house is cold. My people will die. I need fire." Yaga snapped, "Oh yes, I know you and your people. Well, you useless child, you let the fire go out? That's an ill-advised thing to do. And besides, what makes you think I should give you the flame?" Vasilisa consulted her doll and quickly replied, "Because I ask." Baba Yaga purred, "You are lucky. That's the right answer." And Vasilisa felt very lucky she had given the right answer. Baba Yaga threatened, "I cannot possibly give you fire until you've done work for me. If you perform these tasks for me, you shall have the fire. If not..." And here Vasilisa saw Baba Yaga's eyes turn suddenly to red cinders. "If not, my child, you shall die." So Baba Yaga rumbled into the hovel and lay down upon her bed and ordered Vasilisa to bring her what was cooking in the oven. In the oven was enough food for 10 people, and the Yaga ate it all, leaving just a tiny crust and a thimble of soup for Vasilisa. "Wash my clothes, sweep the yard and clean my house, prepare my food and separate the mildewed corn from the good corn, and see that everything is in order. I will be back to inspect your work later. If it's not done, you will be my feast." And with that, Baba Yaga flew off in her cauldron, with her nose as the windsock and her hair as the sail, and it became night again. Vasilisa turned to her doll as soon as the Yaga had gone. "What shall I do? Can I complete these tasks in time?" The doll assured her she could, to eat a little and go to sleep. Vasilisa fed the doll a little too, and then she slept. In the morning, the doll had done all the work, and all that remained was the meal to be cooked. In the evening, the Yaga returned and found nothing undone. Pleased in a way, but not pleased because she could find no fault, Baba Yaga sneered, "You are a very lucky girl," she She then called on her faithful servants to grind the corn, and three pairs of hands appeared in midair and began to rasp and crush the corn. The chaff flew in the house like a golden snow. Finally it was done, and Baba Yaga sat down to eat. She ate for hours and ordered Vasilisa on the morrow to again clean the house, sweep the yard, and launder her clothes. The Yaga pointed to a great mound of dirt in the yard. "In that pile of dirt are many poppy seeds, millions of poppy seeds, and I want in the morning to have one pile of poppy seeds and one pile of dirt all separated out from each other. Do you understand?" Vasilisa almost fainted. "Oh my, how am I going to do that?" She reached into her pocket and the doll whispered, "Don't worry, I will take care of it." That night Baba Yaga snored off to sleep, and Vasilisa tried to pick the poppy seeds out of the dirt. After a time the doll said to her, "Sleep now, all will be well." Again the doll accomplished these tasks, and when the old woman returned home, all was done. Baba Yaga spoke sarcastically through her nose. "Well, lucky for you that you were able to do these things." She called her to her faithful servants to press the oil from the poppy seeds. And again, three pairs of hands appeared and did so. While the Yaga was smearing her lips with grease from her stew, Vasilisa stood nearby. "What are you staring at?" barked Baba Yaga. "May I ask you some questions, grandmother?" asked Vasilisa. "Ask," ordered the Yaga. "But remember, too much knowledge can make a person old too soon." Vasilisa asked about the white man on the white horse. "Aha," said the Yaga fondly, "that first is my day." "And the red man on the red horse?" "Ah, that is my rising sun." "And the black man on the black horse?" "Ah, that is the third, and he is my knight." "I see," said Vasilisa. "Come, come, child, wouldn't you like to ask more questions?" wheedled the Yaga. Vasilisa was about to ask about the pairs of hands that appeared and disappeared, but the doll began to jump up and down in her pocket. So instead Vasilisa said, "No, grandmother, as you yourself say, to know too much can make one old too soon." "Ah," said the Yaga, cocking her head like a bird. "You are wiser than your years, my girl. And how did you come to be this way?" "By the blessing of my mother," smiled Vasilisa. "Blessing?" screeched Baba Yaga. "Blessing? We need no blessings around this house. You'd best be on your way, daughter." She pushed Vasilisa out into the night. "I'll tell you what, child, here." Baba Yaga took a skull with her fiery eyes from her fence and put it on a stick. "Here, take this skull on a stick home with you. There's your fire. Don't say another word. Just be on your way." Vasilisa began to thank the Yaga, but the little doll in her pocket began to jump up and down, and Vasilisa realized she must just take the fire and go. She ran for home through the dark forest, following the turns and twists in the road, as the doll told her which way to go. Vasilisa came through the forest carrying the skull, with fire blazing from its ear, its eye, its nose and mouth holes. Suddenly she became frightened of its weight and its eerie light, and thought to throw it away.